Today, she's sharing some insights on what everyone should know about ASL and American Deaf culture. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Corrine.
Can everyone see me okay? All right, today's a bit of a new experience for everyone. I plan to actually sign my presentation. Now, I'm a hearing individual, but I learned ASL just like you all, right? I started in college at 20, and I picked it up from there. I took ASL classes, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, and right now that's been 20 years, right? Wow. So you can do it. So if I'm hearing, why am I signing? I wonder if anyone has that question. There's three short reasons I'd like to give. The first being, I want to model best practices for everyone who wants to come and work in collaboration with the deaf community. As a hearing person, I have a lot of privilege. And I don't want to force anyone who uses ASL to have to accommodate me and my uses of English. In my lab, I use ASL, for example, and it doesn't matter whether or not you're hearing or deaf. If you want to work with me, you're going to have to learn ASL, right? So that's the best practice for me for collaboration and out of respect for people of other cultures and languages. The second reason being, I know that many of you are ASL students in here, am I right? So as people who are interested in ASL, I wanted you to see a lecture given in ASL. It's a discussion about an academic topic delivered in ASL, and you can use ASL to communicate whatever you need. Third reason being, I think ASL is it's really important that you use ASL to provide community information about the deaf community itself. I know a lot of people in here aren't deaf. Few of you are, and thank you so much for coming. But on Zoom, you have recordings, which means that people down the road have an opportunity to rewatch this lecture. And I want to be able to give them direct communication via ASL, because I am talking about them in their language. I know that it's not mine. I'm talking about their culture and not mine. This is out of respect to them and giving them first access. And first and foremost, access. And now, is everybody ready to see this lecture in ASL? All right. The topic for the day is what everyone should know about ASL. Maybe you're afraid to ask some of these questions that we'll be talking on. I have two parts here. I'll be presenting on ASL as it relates to pop culture. You might have seen a lot of ASL come up in pop culture recently. I'd like to talk a little bit about that. And who uses ASL? What the deaf community looks like in a person that uses ASL? What does the typical ASL user look like? And I'll just be scratching the surface about the ASL's importance in deaf education. Those two subjects are very correlated, and I'd like to talk a little bit about that. The third part here is I'd like to inform everyone and give everyone a sort of crash course, which is an English phrase, in ASL linguistics. I'm a linguist by trade, and I do have to speak on that subject. And the last thing I'd like to talk about is how us as academics in the college environment have influence over social justice as it pertains to deaf culture and deaf events, as well as access and inclusion. I'd like to speak on that. I'd like to shine a spotlight today on ASL. Now, you might have noticed some of the things in the White House, right? The press secretary recently put in an ASL interpreter for her conferences. Have you noticed that? That's the first time in history the United States that we had an ASL interpreter on staff for the White House, which is pretty amazing. Does anyone know why that happens? Because the deaf community sued the government. Could you imagine having to sue them to provide this sort of access, the bare minimum. And that, as a result of the lawsuit, guess what? They won. And now we see two interpreters on screen on our staff for the Biden administration, which is pretty amazing. This woman's name, her name is Elsie Stecker, and she is deaf. So in this instance, you'll have a deaf interpreter and a hearing interpreter act as a sort of team. The hearing interpreter will hear the message in English, relay that to the deaf interpreter, and the deaf interpreter will produce that message in ASL. Now, in other parts of the news or the pop culture you might see today, there's an article recently on a TED Talk. I don't know if you've seen Reese Witherspoon, the actress. She's actually had a book club every month where she picks a book to spotlight. And this month, I don't know if you would know who, it's this woman right here, Sarah Novak. She's a deaf author. And the second here, the one with the blue hair, she's an artist. She's a deaf artist. Christine Sun Kim. She has two exhibits right now in the Smithsonian, which is pretty amazing, which is wow, right? A featured deaf artist to have art in such a prestigious place is pretty incredible. And the two men on the bottom here, these two men performed, can anyone know, can anyone guess? In the Super Bowl, you guys watched the Super Bowl this year? They were chosen by Dr. Dre himself to stand up there and render interpretation for their rap performances. So, which is, it's a lot of visibility for these deaf individuals in the deaf community. Other places where you might see deaf people come up in pop culture is TV shows, right? They have lots of deaf actors featured on TV right now. And for one example is Grey's Anatomy. I don't know if you're familiar with that show. It's been running and on air for a very long time. This woman is Shoshana Sloan Stern. And this is Lauren Ridloff. I don't know if you're familiar with the TV show The Walking Dead. She performs on that show. You guys have watched that. The Bachelor. Maybe some of you might watch that. The Bachelor this season has a deaf contestant. And Netflix just produced a show last year called Deaf You. This exhibits the deaf students' experience at Gallaudet University. I'm not sure if anyone's watched that here. It's a pretty amazing show. It's wow. And the last year, we have a Disney Channel show, Hawkeye, which is sort of a superhero. I don't know if you're familiar with. And the deaf actress here is Alipa Cox, an Indigenous person. So you see a lot of deaf actors and actresses premiering on television. So I don't know if you guys know what the next thing I'm going to mention. Coda, right? Of course. I'm sure a lot of you know this one. The best supporting actor this year was Troy Koster, who is an amazing actor, an amazing deaf performer. This is a poster from the movie up here in the top right. Coda had won Best Picture for 2021. Another actress, you might know, The Quiet Place. Both One and Two features Millie Simmons and Lauren Ridloff again in The Eternals. The sign for that movie is this, sort of a Z from the forehead. I don't know if you know that, but this is amazing stuff. And it is incredible to see deaf actors featured in pop culture, deaf representation, however. A lot of this representation is based on what hearing people perceive to to be deaf culture. So the people who write the movies or write the script or the directors, these are hearing individuals. They don't know much about deaf culture. And they have an image in their head of what that might mean. Oftentimes, these deaf roles are, they have tropes to them. And it sort of assumes a pitiful stance on deaf people. Which comes back to this trope here called hearing benevolence. This was first coined in a study by a deaf PhD, Robinson of 2022. Now, hearing benevolence means essentially that hearing people think that their role is to help deaf people, to pick them up, and essentially serve as patrons to their life, which is something that we find kind of icky. We don't like that. We need to have more deaf people involved from the very beginning, from the writing, with the directing. They need to be in roles where they can say, hey, this is not deaf, this is not actual deaf life. I live the experience and this is what I've seen. We're seeing better examples, better representation, but a lot of the same. And one example of the hearing perspective is this, the medical view of deafness. Which means that hearing people tend to think of deafness as a different disability, as a disease, something to look down on and feel as though it needs to be fixed or cured. They assume that what's best for deaf people is to assimilate into hearing culture, into the hearing world. Now, if you Google the phrase, what is deaf blank, you're going to see the first few options pop up. What is deaf culture? What is deaf community? What is deaf gain? Not bad, right? And do deaf, look at this. Do deaf babies cry? Do deaf people listen to music? Do deaf people drive? This is problematic. The last one here is sign. Is sign language universal? Is sign language hard to learn? Are all sign languages the same language? Is sign language a language? Right? So we see a little bit of the problems here. Now, if we were to get rid of the medical view, what might replace that? A deaf cultural view. And what this means for us here is that the deaf people themselves are being cherished and valued, that deafness is a positive, it contributes. The deaf experience to the community is rich in culture and language, that it's not a negative. This view views deafness as a gain, as a privilege, and hearing people don't think about this. This phrase, deaf gain, is very powerful. And this is how we enact a lens in which deaf people can contribute to society. They can do some things better than hearing people. Life is different, yes. It's not the same as being hearing. But deaf people have the ability that to contribute in a way that is accurately portrayed by deaf gain. Now, you might be thinking, how many signers are actually out there? I think the font here is a little bit small here, but 70 million deaf people use a sign language as their first language, as a primary language. In the US, in Canada, we have about 500,000 people using ASL. And there are different sign languages across the United States and Canada, but I'll be speaking primarily on ASL. And an L1 means first language, right? Primary language. It means language in think about ASL acquisition, how we acquire that language from birth, that is entirely possible the same way as a spoken language is. However, only less than 10% of deaf babies born into deaf parents who sign. That means that only less than 10% are given access to this language from birth. 90% of deaf individuals are born into hearing families. Oftentimes, they're clueless about the deaf culture experience, about sign language, and that they're afraid. They think, oh, my child, they're deaf. What are we going to do? This is awful. What happens in these situations is that they are language deprived. I can't give you this lecture without mentioning language deprivation in the deaf community. Language deprivation is one of the most significant and important topics today in the deaf community. Now, deaf children, they can't hear, right? If I'm a hearing parent speaking to my deaf child, what is that deaf child retaining? What are they hearing? Nothing. Which means that language itself is not forming at a natural pace. They're not able to receive full access to language from a very young and formative age. If you were to provide that same deaf child with a visual language, they would be able to acquire it at a normal pace, just like any hearing child. Unfortunately, a lot of hearing individuals don't know this. Language deprivation does result in hearing parents' ignorance or being generally unaware about this language deprivation problem. This could have a lifelong impact. This lack of access to full language from birth can impact you for the rest of your life. I don't know if you can imagine a deaf parent giving birth to a deaf child and signing to them. The deaf child views all of this and gets that access immediately from a minute old. Now, being born to a hearing family, it won't be maybe until they're 3 or 4 or 5 before they first see ASL or visual language. That's 5 years of just getting by with bits and pieces. And this is such a significant lapse. So now I'd like to show you what a natural language acquisition looks like. I love this video. The kids are adorable. They behave like, you know, kids. I want you to see what can be if you were to provide full access.
Pragmatic language in early childhood education. I am a wolf. A mean wolf. I will eat her grandmother. When she comes, I will capture her. I am bad. I will capture her grandma. She must give me flowers. I am mad. I will capture her. No, I will not swallow her. I will just grab her. I don't want her to lie down and die. The lumberjack will come. A wolf? No, I prefer. Why? I am a wolf. Did you know that I am a red unicorn? I can zoom through the air. I can run really, really fast. And then I soar in the air. I am a rainbow unicorn who can fly easily. I can soar through the air with the wind against my hair. Flap my wings. That's my favorite.
Okay, I'm just going to jump ahead here.
Let me see. He feels frustrated. He feels frustrated because he has a cut on his arm. No, I'm not frustrated. I scratched myself. Oh, he scratched himself.
Who scratched you? I was tired and moving my arms around. I didn't know there was a scratch on my arm. I don't know why. When everybody leaves, I'll give you a Band-Aid. Is that okay? I will help you. I don't want your help. I can help you. I prefer to do it myself.
I'm going to hold for the rest in case we have more time. So, but they're just so adorable. It's just normal language, typical behavior for a little kid. That is what language acquisition looks like. They have access to language right from the get-go, and they behave just like typical kids of their age.
Pragmatic.
Okay, so we just saw a deaf in the classroom. Now we're going to transition to deaf education in America. Just briefly, I do teach a full course about this, and so this is just touching on the surface. You might wonder who uses ASL. ASL is a primary language in Canada and America of deaf people that use American Sign Language. But also, who else uses American Sign Language? Deaf families? Do you know CODA, that movie? The Children of Deaf Adults is what CODA is. And also the abbreviation SODA, S-O-D-A, Siblings of Deaf Adults. Those individuals sign as well. Other people sign. Hearing children of adults who later lose their hearing may pick up American Sign Language. And people such as yourselves in college students, hearing individuals who learn American Sign Language in courses, that you're part of the community as well. It's important to remember that not all deaf people use American Sign Language, and not everyone chooses ASL when they're deaf. They might have a mixture of hearing and deaf individuals that use American Sign Language. So how exactly did ASL emerge? Here's an image of the first deaf school in the United States, Hartford, Connecticut. It was established in 1817. And the deaf children from all over the Eastern Seaboard came to attend. And those individuals had different language experiences prior to coming to school. Some had home signs that they could communicate just sign language with their family, but it wasn't a language other people would understand. And then there's also Martha's Vineyard. Have any of you heard of Martha's Vineyard before? They had several deaf individuals who lived there, and they had their own sign language. Those kids brought their Martha Vineyard language as well to this school. And the educators themselves, what language did they use? French Sign Language. You're probably wondering why would they use French. Those individuals who established this first school, who migrated here from France, brought their language and incorporated it into the education here. And therefore, they used French Sign Language at that time. So a mixture of these different languages that I mentioned, the home signs, the Martha's Vineyard, and the French language, kind of emerged to become ASL. This is just a synopsis, a timeline. Again, the font is very small. I apologize about that. So established the first American school for the deaf in 1817. And then here you see the American Civil War, 1861 to 1865. Prior to that, you notice down below here, the president, Lincoln established Gallaudet College. That's impressive. And then shortly after the war, there was segregation. You remember segregation happened in the South. So deaf individuals who were Black could not attend white schools. So they had to set up a separate school for Black deaf. And this happened in 1868. That was the first Black deaf school. And as time went on, this timeline is not fit to scale, if you will. So think way ahead, over 110 years, 1978 was when the final last school to this desegregate. And so that was Scotlandale, Louisiana. So imagine that. So what happened in between those times in that 100-year time span? Again, mentioning the Black deaf schools, 17 states, including Washington, D.C., had set up segregated schools. The first deaf school for Black students was in North Carolina. And the last one, as I mentioned, was in Louisiana. And at that time, the Black deaf schools had very unique situations because only Black deaf students went there. They weren't with the white students. So that was a situation where white and Black were segregated, led to the emergence of a Black American Sign Language. Black ASL, because they of the segregated schools, so both socially and culturally, they were segregated. Therefore, their own languages emerged. So when the deaf schools were segregated, the Black deaf, most Black deaf had Black teachers, and they had the opportunity to develop their own dialect, if you will, or they had their own vernacular variety, and the dialect might be derogatory, if you will. So I think the variety is better. And then when they integrated again, the Black deaf was the first time they were exposed to white variety American Sign Language. That was the first time they were like, that's American Sign Language? What? They had a hard time communicating. And so they had to adjust and learn to, they had to adjust to the white sign language. So today you will see many Black deaf that have code switching. They'll do code switching where they kind of have to adjust to the Black sign language versus the white sign language, depending on the situation. Okay, so now we're kind of in the middle of my presentation. Okay, I have 15 minutes remaining. Let me think here. Okay, so I'm gonna do a crash course on linguistics of sign language. Again, if you Google sign language and you look for images, this is what will populate. You notice that most of them look like what? Finger spelling. Many hearing people think sign language is equivalent to finger spelling. Imagine deaf people who live through life with every word being fingerspelled. Do you think you could voice fingerspelling of full sentences into English all the time? Nah. So sign language itself is not a full fingerspelling. It's kind of it's not exact wording either of English. It's got its own structure. And it has evolved independently, and same with spoken language, but it has evolved independently. For example, you may think Black Sign Language and British Sign Language and ASL are related, but they are not. Reason being is there is different educational systems in both locations. British Sign Language in Britain, and then they're born and later learn American Sign Language, and then the French Sign Language relevancy is different based on the family and the education systems. So the sign language systems are very different. So how many sign languages are out there? Currently, it has been documented there are 200. I am sure there is a lot more. Many locations in the world that we have not found documented sign language as of yet. As I mentioned moments ago, sign language has its own family, if you will. It doesn't matter if it's English relevant, separate families, if it's based on the families and the educational systems. Here's the old French sign language and how it's been influenced, and then Belgian sign language down to Flemish sign language and French, Belgian, and then it matriculates over to American sign language. But you notice that British sign language is not within this tree. Sign language is not just about the hand. People think like finger spelling is the only way to communicate in sign language. No, we have to incorporate the eyes, the body, sometimes our movements. And also, you know, the movements of our feet. Facial expression. Maybe you noticed I am very expressive. That is part of grammatical features. It's very important. So it's not just about the hands. It's the overall body. I'm going to show you how sign language can be utilized and how the linguist's principles were applied. First thing that you learn is in American Sign Language class, ASL 1, is there are different palm parameters. Those parameters, you can think about like phonetics, phonology, you know, the parts of language, the building blocks to make a sign, if you will. So the first is based on hand shapes. And you see up here images of various hand shapes, many different possible hand shapes. So there are about 30 to 80 hand shapes. People have counted 80. But people who put them into categories, that makes it be about more of 30. ASL has location. Different signs have a location that you use them in the air to produce the sign. So I can't just sign something that's not in the space, right? It has to be out in the space, either on the body or out in front of me. Where I'm placing that sign. It has a location where it's being set up. And then here's a diagram of several different locations for American Sign Language. So it could be on the head, the hand is on the head, at the chin, at the nose, at the forehead. Could be the different fingers on the hand. Could be different locations on the arm, on the body. Okay, do you know what's coming next? Hand shapes, orientation. Movement, yes, right, movement. So how you move the sign can be towards the forward or towards the side or towards me or behind, and it can be cyclical as well. So a candle flickering can be reflecting how the light is bright or dim. There are three different types of movement, but I'm not representing all of them here, so you could ask me later if you wonder about any more. I'm going to question you all about ASL phonology. Are you all experts? Yeah? You are, right? 2 minutes is not enough time to become experts? Okay, so for example, you know the concept minimal pairs. You're familiar with linguistics. If you change one feature, then you can adjust it to make a new word. For example, cat. If you change the C to a B, it becomes bat, right? Same idea here. So the first image, it's only changing the hand shape. That's all, but still on the forehead. The position is on the forehead. It's just changing the hand shape. So we have father is the open five, and then rooster is the three hand shape. and then think is the index finger touching the forehead. So from 5 to 3 to 1, the index finger. Okay, so it's different words based on a different hand shape, but in the same location. And then we can keep the hand shape the same in the next row. So the location is also the same, but we're changing the movement of that sign. So coffee, the top hand, the dominant hand, rotates in a circle, okay? And then the next shape for work, you have coffee is in a circle, and then work kind of pounds, hits on the other hand, and then year, the dominant hand goes around like the globe. So if they're in the same location and in front of the body, it's just a difference of the movement. And in the last row, you can change the location, but keep the same hand shape and keep the same movement, but just change the location. So summer at the top of the forehead with his index finger becoming like an X hand shape, and then near the nose, okay, for ugly, and then down lower to the chin for dry. All the same hand shape and movement. See that? Just like cat versus bat and sat. Just a slight little twist of the word. And so now I'm going to give a turn to you guys.
All right, that's your first test. You see father, mother. What's the difference here? Location. Yes, yeah, location. Father's on the forehead, mother's on the chin. Is that it? Okay, perfect. Okay, now we have green and blue. Green and blue. That's right, hand shape. You have a G here and a B for blue. The motion is the same. Kind of goes back and forth here in the same spot. Meaning entirely different things. That's correct. Last one here. A little bit tricky. Because technically there's two things different, but I'll take just one answer. If you notice two, that's great. Now you have game and competition. Game, competition. One's movement, correct. And the second one is palm orientation, that's correct. One palm orientation faces one another, while the other one sort of faces outward. Now there's two, I guess these are two minimal pairs, but it's not exact. All right, good job. Now we're talking about morphology. Now we have the sign for orange. Now I'm from Syracuse, you know, Syracuse University, right? That's our mascot, Otto, right? So I have to teach you the sign for orange, am I right? This is the sign for orange. But if I wanted it to be a bright orange, or maybe a dark orange, there's also neon, which is essentially, it just means loud, like a loud color, a loud sound, loud orange. But you have dark, you have bright, you have loud, neon. These are sort of morphological modifiers. It essentially describes whether a color is dark or light or bright. That's typical with English, right? We have words that add to the meaning. Now this part's cool. Now, sign language can have a simultaneous morphology. These are not concurrent, but simultaneous. So for the sign for dance, now if I wanted to say something to the effect of something serious, like a serious dance, I don't sign serious dance. This is how I'd sign it. Reflecting on my face. My pursed lips indicate that that is a very serious motion. And it changes the meaning of the word dance. We wouldn't say dance hard. We would say dance like this, with their teeth gnashed and saying, hey, we dance real hard. the mouth movements add to the morphology. We don't say an easy dance. We say a dance like so, with their lips pursed in this way to really inflect that meaning. ASL does have both simultaneous and concurrent morphology, which are two very different types, right? Okay, so now we have lexical variation. So this is what where we might see accents or dialect. We have regional accents, so different signs for the same thing. Maybe you know the word soda in English, right? Do you have different words for that where you come from? Pop, maybe. Yeah, pop, right? Coke, anyone? Coke, people from the South, Coke. So different words, same concept. ASL has the same exact thing. Take a look. So many signs for birthday, right? And I got one more for you. Donuts. It's a very important concept. Lots of signs for donuts. Same exact concept in English. Different words, same concepts. I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to skip this one. This is the sign for underwear. There is variation on this as well. So now I'm going to touch very briefly on the topic of social justice. Can't come to campus and give a presentation without touching on this topic. ASL in higher education. Enrollment in ASL classes are at an all-time high in post-secondary classes. However, at deaf schools, enrollment is dropping off, but with hearing individuals taking ASL classes, those numbers are skyrocketing. It's the third most popular language after Spanish and French. 2010 was the last time I could find any numbers on this, but 90,000 students registered and enrolled in college classes for ASL. The understanding that ASL is still not accepted as a foreign language in most places. How about that? Wow, am I right? Now, we're very fortunate here that in 2018, right? Congrats to everyone at Cornell. And next year, Syracuse University will officially verify ASL as a foreign language in 2022. Actually, it's like this year, yes. All right, right? That's exciting. Yeah, it's about time. Yeah, it's about time, right? Now, regardless of the ASL popularity and language growth, language-related educational efforts can promote social justice as well. We can talk about culture. We can talk about the deaf rights, learn about deaf accessibility and how to make campus a more accessible place for our deaf colleagues and classmates. We need to become an ally in order to support this sort of change. Ideology is the belief about language. Now, good ASL often reproduces racist and can also reproduce racist and classist beliefs. So we talked a little bit about Black ASL and white ASL. Now, we would think that with those two things being signified, that Hispanic ASL is of a lesser category, of a lesser variety. But no, we need to work on pulling them all up to the same sort of importance and register. So here, and again, ASL is a sort of cash cow. Are you familiar with the concept? You can get a lot of money from teaching ASL. At Cornell? Cornell, is that the sign? Cornell? Cornell, I guess you fingerspell it. All right. They earn money from students taking ASL classes. However, there are still concerns about access. And we don't see much effort to hire people, who are deaf outside of the ASL program. At my university, I'm aware of one deaf faculty member at the whole campus, the whole university, just one. Yeah, out of how many faculty? I don't know, but there's only one, and that's not good. Now, here's what we can do. First, hire more deaf people, right? It's not hard. And it's not just hire deaf people for teaching ASL. And of course, deaf people can teach ASL. But they're frequently, they frequently graduate with degrees with ASL education, but many deaf people are just not interested in that. They want to do biology, chemistry, engineering. Those deaf peoples, they have PhDs. They can teach engineering. But do we see deaf engineers here? I doubt it. We need to make room, essentially. We need to hire deaf individuals and not shoehorn them into ASL education as well, exclusively. That's fine, but we need to add more opportunities for them. Deaf people who are on campus are typically whites. We need to focus on more non-white deaf individuals, Hispanic, Native American, Black. We need to make space, as well as Asian. Mm-hmm. Cornell and Syracuse are very similar in that they're both prestigious, right? And do they collaborate with the local deaf community? Well, I think they can do better. That's really what I'm trying to push for here at Syracuse, trying to pair them up with different deaf communities and deaf groups. Now, I run ASL program, but I'm not getting money from teaching ASL while also losing the deaf community and losing their language. I incorporate them. I bring them in to the fold. The phrase make space is very important here. And honestly, do better. And you know who has a lot of power? The students. More than me. When a student complains or makes noise, the administration, they listen. When I complain, they can shoo me away. They don't care. That get my paycheck, and as far as they're concerned, I should be satisfied, but you are paying students. You pay for your courses. You pay tuition. They'll listen to you. So please think about that. You have that power. Now, if you don't remember anything else from today, remember this slide. You have the opportunity to make change on your campus. Now, if you want to, you can do it. Okay? Yes? Yes? Nods? All right. And I think that's it. Oh, it's my dog. I love him. Thank you so much for your attention. I really do appreciate you coming to my presentation. Yay, yes. It's warm in here.
Wow. Thank you.
This was wonderful. So interesting for me, and I have to admit I'm part of the problem, right? I don't sign, and that needs to change. So Brenda, you'll be seeing me in your class.
You're doing great. You're doing great. Other than not learning sign language, thank you.
Nice. So at this point in time, we would like to open the floor for questions. And I think what we may need to do for the Zoom audience, if we have questions from here, Jordan, I don't know if maybe you can step up here and sign it back, or if you can sign the question so the camera is there.
Sure.
So do we have questions here in the audience?
So thank you so much. I was just so interested and fascinated by your presentation. You mentioned that there are 200 sign languages in the world. So I'm wondering, do you define those as discrete languages? And are many of those mutually intelligible to ASL? And what would be the closest one?
That is an awesome question. Thank you. So the short answer is many of the languages are related to ASL because of the colonialism, you know, about taking over, exporting to different countries. So American Sign Language education was referred to other places, like in South America, Asia, Africa. Those individuals incorporated ASL because ASL individuals went to those countries and locations and taught them. And so in Kenya, their sign language, they use American Sign Language. Brazilian language is ASL. And Chinese also use American Sign Language. I just learned that myself. Yeah, I was very surprised by that. I had a Chinese student in my class this year, and she was showing me the ASL, and they're like 75%, and I was watching and I could understand. So it's gone over there to China as well. And different languages, of course, that international language, that's kind of a tricky question, because what is a language or a dialect? You know, that's kind of a sticky question. So that's the same for spoken languages as well. So there's Norway, there's Sweden, the Finnish, the different languages. I mean, they all interact with each other, but, you know, do they have their own individual languages? Because, you know, of politics and country boundaries and wars, American Sign Language, I mean, in America, we're very independent. We don't have a lot of shared, you know, borders. I that might be the closest, maybe France. I really don't know how to answer that. Brenda is saying places like Australia have strong relations with BSL. So those are considered separate languages. I'm not sure either. That might be more of a dialect. But I think the Australian individuals can understand the British Sign Language, yeah. So it's easier to pick up different languages. So I have another similar question related to American Sign Language in other countries. So related to the question that was just asked, do you want me to copy sign for the deaf in the front here? Okay, great. So from what I have learned recently at graduate school, I learned something new myself related to languages that are similar to American Sign Language. Here, American Sign Language is pretty predominant, but say in the 1950s and on, even in America, they would send people to other countries, you know, Asia, Hawaii, several different countries to teach ASL in those different countries, but there are some pros and cons, because then that would take over their country. They would have their own language in those countries, but ASL would then become the dominant language instead of the original language that was there. So you're starting to see more and more deaf individuals who are using ASL, but they're from other countries, and they assimilate because of the people that have gone there from America to teach in those countries. So it's similar to American Sign Language, but it's still, you know, not necessarily documented that has been taking place, and there's not enough research presently to provide that documentation.
Yeah, I totally 100% agree with what you just stated.
This is Brenda. I just want to add to this whole conversation. Yes, there are definitely negative impacts taking away their sign languages to those countries, the native language. But we try to bolster them and encourage them to communicate. Many people see American Sign Language as an economic opportunity. Oh, you can learn American Sign Language. That means I can go to Gallaudet University and, you know, I get a degree and get a graduate level degree. And they see American Sign Language as an opportunity and leading to other things. So
that's similar to English, right? People who want to learn English as a second language because of the economic opportunities. So it's on the same wavelength. Okay, any other questions? I started learning American Sign Language. And when you graduate, how do you continue to learn the language and incorporate in deaf culture and with the community? That is a great question. For myself, what happened to me, I got a job at NTID. So that's a great place to learn, assimilate, be around deaf people, and live there in Rochester and Washington, DC as well. There are so many deaf people that you bump into. They're all over. If that's not the situation, look on Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, you know, some different places. I mean, it sounds funny, but those social media provide opportunities for deaf coffee hours, going, you know, out of town, meeting different individuals. So I just moved here recently in Syracuse in August. So I'm trying to learn about the deaf community. And there are events popping up here and there that, I mean, I really have to work to find them, you know, but you just have to make the effort to reach out to individuals and use American Sign Language, practice it and use it. That will open up the door for you. Thank you. Yes.
I would just ask, I'm not sure, I know we don't have a lot of time, but maybe what would be one or two recommendations you might have that hearing faculty can do to better support students who are deaf in their courses?
Oh, thank you. That's a good question. One thing here that I just learned from Brenda, we had a nice conversation. She has conversation time for faculty to learn. Is that once a week on Wednesdays from 4:30 for 1 hour, where everybody comes together, you meet different people, and it's beginner ASL, you know, the very basics to communicate, just, you know, nice things like hello, nice to see you, how are you, how was your weekend, you know, little everyday talk to show that you're supportive and you're including. If not language, maybe little things that you can do. I used to teach blended classrooms with both deaf and hearing individuals. And what I found for deaf individuals, the turn taking was a challenge because there would be an interpreter who has a lag behind the teacher. So the deaf student doesn't have the opportunity to respond to questions like the hearing students do because the interpreter is well behind. And so what I do is I use a system where I would ask the students to
use a number, one or two, raised your hand as a one or a two, so that I continue the, should I continue the topic? You do a one. So that can include that individual. But if I'm going to change the topic, I then put up a hand of two. So a one or two, so that helps the students contribute to the conversation without the hearing students taking over, if you know what I'm saying. Or you could do, I have another person that uses a really fun, kind of like a Nerf type of a toy. They throw it to the students, if you don't mind throwing things at the students or them throwing at you, but like a little Nerf ball, as whoever has the Nerf ball has the floor. So, I mean, that can be tough for individuals as well, and also hard for, you know, if the interpreter is in the classroom. So, but you can look at the interpreter as the educator, wait for the interpreter to stop their communication, and then focus, you know, on the deaf person. So it's more about strategic room management, and giving them the ability to participate equally. Okay. So basically, related to captioning the videotapes as well, you don't know how many videotapes are not captioned, and that's, you know, like basic 101. So if you are showing videos in your classroom, please make sure they are captioned. I'm not talking about YouTube captioned videos. Those are horrific. You have to, you can learn how to produce or make your own script, and add it to the YouTube video, which it's very easy. And there are a lot of services out there as well that you can reach out to caption those videos as well.
So being mindful of time, there is one question on Zoom. Jeanette is asking if there is a difference if you are left-handed and how that is being accommodated.
Yes, that's a great question. People who are left-handed tend to have their dominant signs by their left hand. So that you see some people that use one hand. So for think, hear with the index finger, that's with the dominant hands. But if I use my right hand, but if I'm a left-handed person, I would use my left index finger to do those same signs. So 90% of people are right-handed, but those southpaws, sometimes you'll see, I think it's tough for ASL teachers to try to learn to kind of reverse looking receptively at the left-handed signers, but over time you kind of pick it up. So I don't really notice it anymore. And Brenda's saying, if I have left-handed students, I try to accommodate them, and I will focus on the left-handed signs and how to sign with my left hand. But it's really fun to have left-handed students to provide that challenge. It's a different experience.
Wonderful. Well, thank you all for joining us here this afternoon, whether in person or on Zoom. Corrine, thank you so much. This was very inspiring. I also want to give a shout out to the interpreters. Thank you for being here. This blows my mind what you do. I mean, I'm bilingual, but I feel that is nothing compared to what you are doing here. So thank you all for coming. Thank you, Brenda, for spearheading all of this.
Do a thing.
Well, the program at Cornell is here because of you. So thank you also, Matilda and Nora. Enjoy your evening, and we hope to see you at our next event. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.